All right, we have a bunch of shows to talk about, and obviously, in terms of national television, the biggest would be the debut of Rampage, which I thought was a great debut show.
It was a great one hour, yeah.
And man, I watched this show, and when it was over, I thought, if this really is a Friday, 42-minute after commercials, A show, I mean, this might win the Observer Award this year over Dynamite.
I don't think it will, because I don't think people will consider, but well, you know what, it's only 1 week, who knows? I mean, you can't, you know, they got to do it week after week after week. The impression I have, and again, I got some market ratings for Dynamite, for Rampage, but you know, it's just some markets, but in the markets that I've seen, it's about 2/3 to 3/4 in that range. So let's go like 70% of what Dynamite did.
About so 700,000.
Well, that would be a huge success if that's the number. But it's between, you know, and again, I've only got some markets, so it's hard to really say. But from the markets that I saw, it did. You know, that's what it did. So. You know, we'll see. There were markets where it beat Dynamite, but most markets it did not. There were markets where it was only half, but most looked to be 2/3 to 3/4.
Well, the show opened. We got four announcers, by the way: Excalibur, Taz, Jericho, and Mark Henry. And a lot of people talking about the commentary. And the thing to me with the commentary is,
I thought Excalibur was great.
He was great. But here's the deal with four people.
It was tough.
When you got four people, you essentially, everybody has to speak in sound bites. Because yep. You're going to say something quick, and then you throw to Chris Jericho, and then he throws to Mark Henry. And it's hard to have a conversation when you've got four commentators that are literally all there to do like quick sound bites. So it didn't hurt the show to me. I think it would have been much better. I think every wrestling show would be better with just two announcers, but
some shows could work with three, but I think two or three is optimum.
Two seems to be the ideal, because you can have a conversation.
Yeah, I've seen. You know what though? I always thought two was the right number, but I've seen three work. So I don't know that there's like a perfect number. It's really dependent on who the announcers are, but four did feel like it would be too much. And watching it, four did feel too much.
So it opened up with Christian and Kenny Omega for the Impact title, and as we'd pretty much expected, Christian won the title, and this crowd, whatever you want to say about the reaction on Dynamite when he came out, and you know, everybody was chanting for CM Punk, they were chanting yes, 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 they weren't into the idea of him challenging. This was a 100% pro-Christian crowd for this match here. And they had a very fun match.
Well, at the beginning, it was a split crowd, but it was super loud. But the way they worked the match, I mean, they worked a babyface heel traditional match. And, you know, Omega was selling for him and giving him the teases of the near falls and everything like that, which brought the crowd in. And it was, it was a great worked match. It was not a normal Kenny Omega style match. It was more, I mean, it was a mix. I mean, it was a mix of a Kenny Omega match and a Christian Cage match, but I felt flow-wise, I felt more like I was watching a Christian Cage match and Kenny Omega doing a Ray Stevens basic job there, which is, you know, his role is to make the other guy, not, and look, it's not that Christian isn't good or anything like that, but his job is to make the other guy look like a world champion and make the other guy look the best he can look. You know, it's kind of like Ric Flair's role, and I thought he did it tremendously. And that's why, you know, it was a hot crowd anyway. But it made the crowd even hotter because of the way the match was worked.
Callis took the ref. Omega hit a low blow. Young Bucks came down to the ring, slid a chair into the ring. Omega was going to do the one winged angel, but Christian reversed it and hit the kill switch on the chair. And Kenny Omega took the greatest bump for this kill switch on a chair. And Christian covered him, got the pin, won the title, which I guess the Impact title is the Impact and the TNA title, because he left with both belts.
He took both belts, yeah.
Yep. So they had the Jurassic Express come out. Scott D'Amore is out there. big celebration, place is going crazy. Christian cuts a promo afterwards just saying, you know, it's going to be nearly impossible to win that AEW title at the pay-per-view from Kenny Omega, but I am in his head. So that's what they needed to do if they're going to make that the main event of the pay-per-view.
They have to
convince the fans that he can beat Kenny Omega.
Yeah.
And look, he did.
If that's the direction, then they did what they should have done. You know, the deal is like, the, you know, the original plan was Adam Page, and obviously because of you know, Adam Page's wife being about to give birth, he pulled out of the show. So because of that, they had to make a change in, you know, just the last couple of weeks, and the pick was Christian. I mean, what they did as far as the win here to set that up, because they had nobody else set up, that was great. That was great. It was, you know, the argument is, should it have been Christian? You know, there's a lot of different people you could have gone with. You know, and there's, and none of them are perfect, and all, you know, and all of them are, you know, there's just many different ways you could have gone. I don't know that he was the best, but he was the one picked. And again, some of it probably has to do with, you know, Impact probably, since they were going to do it this way and they were going to put the Impact Championship on, you got to have D'Amore and Tommy Dreamer, you know, they're going to have to, in some sense, it's like, look, you're putting your world title, their world title on somebody. So it's got to be somebody that they were okay with, and they, you know, and someone who, they were okay with bringing in and bringing over. And, you know, again, I don't know who else was suggested. I know that D'Amore and Christian are good friends. So, and, you know, D'Amore was instrumental, if you remember, many, many, many years ago, like 16 years ago, whatever it was, when Christian left WWE to become the TNA champion, and to go to TNA and to do the unbeaten thing and everything, be the top guy with Sting in TNA. And so, you know, they have that long-standing relationship. I mean, there's a, you know, the match was really, really good. And, you know, so as far as like it not being a great pay-per-view match, it probably will be, you know, but there's also the idea of, you know, is, and because of the age and everything, is that the right guy? And from a TNA standpoint, I mean, you've got like a main event on your next big show of Christian Cage against Brian Myers, and that sounds so underwhelming. It's not even funny for a big show main event, but there are plenty of different picks you could have picked. Darby wouldn't have fit because I think Darby's got other things to do. I don't think Jungle Boy was the right choice. Jericho, but Jericho's got his thing going on. But there's, you know, you can go up and down the roster of different choices. And, you know, like from me, want somebody younger? Yeah. But, you know, when it comes right down to it, when it comes to a situation like this, where something has changed at the last minute, it's not your original plan, it's not a perfect pick. And so that was the pick. They did as good a job as they were going to do. The match was as good a match as it was going to be. And there you go.
Hey, if you're a big fan of Wrestling Observer Radio, we got 12,000 episodes of all of our podcasts up at our website, WrestlingObserver.com. If you sign up today, you get access to every single one of them. The 12 to 18 new shows that we do every single week. You can podcast them, listen to them on the road, at work, working out, in the shower, wherever you listen to your podcasts, and also full access to the Wrestling Observer newsletter and archives. So if you love what you hear, head to WrestlingObserver.com. 12,000 audio shows at your fingertips.